Hello, everybody. It's Ashley Brock. And I know my handle says Lee Man. Lee Man is just my YouTube handle. And it's from when I wasn't married. My name was Ashley Hardman. So it's last part of my first name and last part of my last name. That's where that came from. And I realized I didn't give you really an introduction in my first one. I'm a nerd, a big nerd. And I know I look old. I'm only 33 years old. I have two kids. You'll hear them in the background because I don't have a soundproof studio. I'm not a famous YouTuber. I'm just doing this so book nerds like myself can listen to audiobooks in their car while they're working out, whatever they want to do. If you're not a book nerd, that's fine with me. I don't really care. I'm 33 years old. I'm married. I got two kids, and I do this in my free time. Spare time, because I feel like people don't read anymore, and that's a bit of a shame. So I do this for everybody else. And like I said, I apologize if you hear my kids in the background, but I don't have a soundproof studio or anything else like that because I'm not a famous YouTuber. And I like to read, and I like to make them into audiobooks. And if you watched my other video, you would tell that I changed their voices and all that stuff. I try to make audiobooks more interesting because I know most of them are on actual audiobook sites and all that stuff. They are usually monotone and very annoying, and like, it's very boring to want to listen to them. So I try to make them a little bit more interesting. And most of my books, 99% of my books, are romance books. So if you don't like romance novels, this is also not the right place for you. And I'm also a big anime nerd, so I might do later on down the road, I might do some like anime top 10 lists or something like that, but I'm not quite sure. Anyways, if you like this stuff, that's cool. If you don't like it, that's cool too. I don't really care. I'm just doing this because I think there's some people out there that likes books and that they don't have the time to read, but they wish they did. And so while they're busy doing other things, they can listen to an audiobook that's actually, in my opinion, is interesting. I might not be interesting. I don't really care. Like I said, I'm just doing this because I feel like it needs to be done. All right, so here is Nora Roberts' book, Sea Swept, Chapter 1. Nora Roberts, Sea Swept, Chapter 1. Cam called in markers, pulled strings, begged favors, and threw money in a dozen directions. Hooking transportation from Monaco to Maryland's eastern shore at 1 o'clock in the morning wasn't an easy matter. He drove to Nice, bulleting down the winding coastal highway to a small airship where a friend had agreed to fly him to Paris for the nominal fee of $1,000 American. In Paris, he chartered a plane for half again the going rate and spent the hours over the Atlantic in a blur of fatigue and gnawing fear. He arrived at Washington Dulles Airport in Virginia at just after 6 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. The rental car was waiting, so he began the drive to the Chesapeake Bay in the dark chill of pre-dawn. By the time he hit the bridge crossing the bay, the sun was up and bright, sparkling off the water, glittering off boats already out for the day's catch. Cam had spent a good part of his life sailing on the bay, on the rivers and inlets of this part of the world. The man he was racing to see had shown him more, much more, than port and starboard. Whatever he had, whatever he'd done, that he could take pride in, he owed to Raymond Quinn. He'd been 13 and racing toward hell when Ray and Stella Quinn had plucked him out of the system. His juvenile record was already a textbook study of the roots of the career criminal. Robbery, breaking and entering, underage drinking, truancy, assault, vandalism, malice mischief. He'd done as he'd pleased, and even then had often enjoyed long runs of luck where he hadn't been caught. But the luckiest moment of his life had been being caught. 13 years old, skinny as a rail, and still wearing the bruises from the latest beating his father had administered, they'd been out of beer. What was a father to do? On that hot summer night with the blood still drying on his face, Cam had promised himself he was never going back to that run-down trailer, to that life, to the man the system kept tossing him back to. He was going somewhere, anywhere, maybe California, maybe Mexico. His dreams had been big, even in his vision, courtesy of a blackened eye, was blurry. He had $56 and some loose change, the clothes on his back and a piss-poor attitude. What he needed, he decided, was transportation. He copped a ride in the cargo car of a train heading out of Baltimore. He didn't know where it was going and didn't care as long as it was away. Huddled in the dark, his body weeping at every bump, he promised himself he'd kill or he'd die before he went back. When he crept off the train, he smelled water and fish, and he wished to God he'd thought to grab some food somewhere. His stomach was screaming empty, dizzy and disoriented. He began to walk. There wasn't much there, a two-bit little town that had rolled up its streets for the night, boats bumping at saggy docks. If his mind had been clear, he might have considered breaking into one of the shops that lined the waterfront, but it didn't occur to him until he had passed through town and found himself skirting a marsh. The marsh's shadows and sounds gave him the willies. The sun was beginning to break through the eastern sky, turning those muddy flats and that high, wet grass gold. Huge white bird rose up, making Cam's heart skip. He'd never seen a heron before, and he thought it looked like something out of a book, a made-up one. But the wings flashed, and the bird soared. For reasons he couldn't name, he followed it along the edge of the marsh until it disappeared into thick trees. He lost track of how far and what direction, but instinct told him to keep to a narrow country road where he could easily tuck himself into the high grass or behind a tree if a black and white cruised by. He barely wanted to find shelter, somewhere he could curl up and sleep away the pangs of hunger and the greasy nausea. As the sun rose higher, the air grew thick with heat. His shirt stuck to his back. His feet began to weep. He saw the car first, a glossy white Vetta, all power and grace, sitting like a grand prize in the midst of the light of dawn. There was a pickup beside it, rusted, rugged, and ridiculously royal beside the arrogant sophistication of the car. Cam crouched down behind the lushy, blooming hydrilla and studied it, lust after it. The son of a bitch would get him to Mexico, all right, and anywhere else he wanted to go. Shit. The way a machine like that would move, he'd be halfway there before anybody knew it was gone. He shifted, blinked hard to clear his wavering vision, and stared at the house. It always amazed him that people lived so neatly, in tidy houses with painted shutters, flowers and trim bushes in the yard, rockers on the front porch, screens on the windows. The house seemed huge to him, a modern white palace with soft blue trim. They'd be rich, he decided, as resentment ground in his stomach, along with hunger. They could afford fancy houses and fancy cars and fancy lives, and a part of him, part nurtured by a man who lived on hate and Budweiser, wanted to destroy, to beat all the bushes flat, to break all the shiny windows and gouge the pretty painted wood to splinters. He wanted to hurt them somehow, for having everything while he had nothing, but as he rose, the bitter fury wavered into sick dizziness. He clamped down on it, clenching his teeth until they, too, ached, but his head cleared. Let the rich bastard sleep, he thought. He just relieved them of the hot car. Wasn't even locked, he noted, and snorted at their ignorance as he eased the door open. One of the more useful skills his father had passed on to him was how to hotwire a car, quickly and quietly. Such a skill came in very handy when a man made the best part of his living selling stolen cars to chop shops. Cam leaned in, shimmering on the wheel, and got to work. It takes balls to steal a man's car right out of his own driveway. Before Cam could react, even so much as swear, a hand hooked into the back of his jeans and hauled him up and out. He swung out, and his bunched fists seemed to bounce off rock. He got his first look at the mighty Quinn. The man was huge, at least 6'5", and built like the offensive lineman of the Baltimore Colts. His face was weathered and wide, with a thick shock of blonde hair that glittered with silver around it. His eyes were piercing blue and hotly annoyed. Then they narrowed. It didn't take much to hold the boy in place. He couldn't have weighed 100 pounds, Quinn thought. If he'd fished the kid out of the bay, his face was filthy and badly battered. One eye was nearly swollen shut, while the other, dark slant gray, held a bitterness no child should feel. There was blood dried on the mouth that managed to sneer despite it. Pity and anger stirred in him, but he kept his grip firm. This rabbit, he knew, would run. Looks like you came out on the wrong end of a tussle, son. Get your fucking hands off me. I wasn't doing nothing. Ray merely lifted a brow. You were in my wife's new car at just past 7 on a Saturday morning. I was just looking for some loose chains. What's the big fucking deal? You don't want to get in the habit of overusing the word fuck as an adjective. You'll miss the vast variety of its uses. The mild tutorial tone was well over Cam's head. Look, Jack, I was just hoping for a couple bucks and quarters. You wouldn't miss it. No, but Stella would have nearly missed this car if you'd finished hot wiring it. And my name is Jack. It's Ray. Now, the way I figure it, you've got a couple of choices. Let's outline number one. I haul your sorry butt into the house and call the cops. How do you feel about doing the next few years in a juvenile facility for badasses? Whatever color Cam had left in his face drained away. His empty stomach heaved, his palms suddenly covered in sweat. He couldn't stand a cage. Was sure he would die in a cage. I said I wasn't still in the goddamn car. It's a 4-speed. How the hell am I supposed to drive a 4-speed? Oh, I have a feeling you'd manage just fine. Ray puffed out his cheeks, considered, then blew out air. Now, choice number two.
Ray, what are you doing out there with that boy?
Ray glanced toward the porch, where a woman with wild red hair in a ratty blue robe stood with her hands on her hips. Just discussing some life choices. He was still in your car.
Well, for heaven's sake!
Somebody beat the crap out of him, too. Recently, I'd say.
Well?
Stella Quinn's sigh could be heard clear across the dewy green lawn.
Bring him in, and I'll take a look at him. Hell of a way to start the morning. Hell of a way. No, you get inside there, idiot dog. Fine one you are. Never want to bark when my car's being stolen.
My wife, Stella. Ray's smile spread and glowed. She just gave you choice number two. Hungry? The voice was buzzing in Cam's head. A dog was barking in high, delighted yelps from miles and miles away. Birds sang shrilly and much too close by. His skin went brutally hot, then brutally cold, and he went blind. Steady there, son. I'll get you. Fell into the oily black and never heard Ray's quiet oath. When he woke, he was lying on a firm mattress in a room where the breeze ruffled the sheer curtains and carried in the scent of flowers and water. Humiliation and panic rose up in him. Even as he tried to sit up, hands held him down.
Just lie still a moment.
He saw the long, thin face of the woman who leaned over him, poking, prodding. There were thousands of gold freckles over it, which for some reason he found fascinating. Her eyes were dark green and frowning. Her mouth was set in a thin, serious line. She scraped back her hair, and she smelled faintly of dusting powder. Cam realized abruptly that he'd been stripped down to his tattered jockeys. The humiliation and panic exploded. Get the hell away from me! His voice came out on a croak of terror, infuriating him.
Relax now, relax. I'm a doctor. Look at me.
Stella leaned her face close.
Look at me now. Tell me your name.
His heart thundered in his chest. John?
Smith, I imagine, she said dryly. Well, if you have the presence of mind to lie, you're not doing too badly.
She shined a light in his eyes and grunted.
I'd say you've got yourself a mild concussion. How many times have you passed out since you were beat up?
That was the first. He felt himself collaring under her unblinking stare and struggling not to squirm. I'm not sure. I have to go.
Yes, you do. To the hospital.
No? Terror gave him the strength to grab her arm before she could rise. If he ended up in the hospital, there would be questions. With questions came cops. With cops came the social workers. And somehow, before it was over, he'd end up back in that trailer. That stink of stale beer and pissed with a man who found his greatest relief and pounded on a boy half his size. I'm not going to any hospital. I'm not. Just give me my clothes. Got some money. I'll pay for the trouble. I have to go.
She said again. Tell me your name. Your real one.
Cam. Cameron.
Cam, who did this to you?
I don't.
Don't lie to me!
She snapped. Then he couldn't. His fear was too huge, and his head was starting to throb so fiercely he could barely stop the whimper. My father.
Why?
Because he likes to. Stella pressed her fingers against her eyes, then lowered her hands and looked out the window. She could see the water, blue as summer, the trees thick with leaves, and the sky, cloudless and lovely. And in such a fine world, she thought, there were parents who beat their children just because they liked to, because they could, because they were there.
All right, We'll take this one step at a time. You've been dizzy, experiencing blurred vision.
Cautious, Kim, not a, maybe some, but I haven't eaten in a while.
Race down, take care of that. Better in the kitchen than me. Your ribs are bruised, but they're not broken. The eye's the worst of it.
She murmured, touching a gentle finger to the swelling.
We can treat that here. We'll clean you up and doctor you and see how you do. I am a doctor.
She told him again and smiled at as her hand, blissfully cool, smoothed his hair back.
A pediatrician?
That's a kid's doctor.
He's still qualified, tough guy, if I don't like how you do.
You're going in for x-rays. She reached into her bag for an instant.
This is going to sting a little.
He winced, sucked in his breath as she began to treat his face. Why are you doing this? She couldn't stop herself. With her free hand, she brushed back a messy shock of his dark hair.
Because I like to?
They kept him. It had been as simple as that, Cam thought now, or so it had seemed to him at the time. He hadn't realized until years later how much work, effort, and money they invested in first fostering, then adopting him. They'd given him their home, their name, and everything worthwhile in his life. They lost Stella nearly 8 years ago to cancer, and that had snuck into her body and eaten away at it. Some of the light had gone out of that house, on the outskirts of the little water town of St. Christopher's, and out of Ray, out of Cam, and out of the two other lost boys they made their own. Cam had gone racing, anything, anywhere. Now he was racing home to the only man he'd ever considered his father. He'd been to this hospital countless times, when his mother had been on staff, and then when she'd been in treatment for the thing that killed her. He walked in, punchy and panicked, and asked for Raymond Quinn at the administration desk.
He's in intensive care, family only.
I'm his son. Cameron turned away and headed for the elevator. He didn't have to be told what floor, he knew too well. Saw Philip the moment the doors opened into ICU. How bad? Philip handed over one of the two cups of coffee he held. His face was pale with fatigue, his normally well-groomed tawny hair tousled by his hands. His long, somewhat angelic face was roughened by stubble, and his eyes, a pale golden brown, shadowed with exhaustion. I wasn't sure you'd make it. It's bad, Cam. Christ. I've got us in a minute. He stepped into a small waiting area and dropped into a chair. The can of Coke in the pocket of his tailored suit clunked. For a moment, he stared blindly at the morning show, running brightly on the TV screen.
What happened?
Cam demanded.
Where is he? What did the doctor say?
He was heading home from Baltimore. At least Ethan thinks he'd gone to Baltimore for something. He had a telephone pole. Dead on. He pressed the heel of his hand to his heart because it ached every time he pictured it. They say maybe he had a heart attack or a stroke and lost control, but they're not sure yet. He was driving fast. Too fast. He had to close his eyes because his stomach kept trying to jump into his throat. Too fast, he repeated. It took them nearly an hour to cut him out of the wreck. Nearly an hour. The paramedic said he was concussed on and off. It was just a couple miles from here. He remembered the Coke in his pocket, opened the can, and drank. He kept trying to block the image out of his head to concentrate on the now and the what happened next. They got a hold of Ethan pretty quick, Philip continued. When he got here, Dad was in surgery. He's in a coma now. He looked up, met his brother's eyes. They don't expect him to come out of it.
That's bullshit. He's strong as an ox.
They said. Philip closed his eyes again. His head felt empty, and he had to search for everything.
Massive trauma, brain damage, internal injuries. He's on life support. The surgeon, he...
Dad's a registered organ donor.
Fuck that.
Cam's voice was low and furious. Do you think I want to consider it? Philip Rose now, tall, rangy man in a wrinkled $1,000 suit. They said it's a matter of hours at most. The machines are keeping him breathing. God damn it, Cam. You know how Mom and Dad talked about this when she got sick. No extreme measures. They made living wills and we're ignoring his because we can't stand not to.
You want to pull the plug?
Cam reached out, grabbed Philip by the lapels.
You want to pull the goddamn plug on him?
Weary and sick at heart. Philip shook his head. I'd rather cut my hand off. I don't want to lose him any more than you do. You better see for yourself. He turned, led the way down the corridor, where the scent was hopelessness not quite masked by antiseptics. They moved through double doors, past the nurse's station, past small glass-fronted rooms where machines beeped and hoped hung stubbornly on.
Ethan was sitting in a chair by the bed when they walked in. His big, colossal hand was through the guard and covering Ray's. His tall, wiry body was bent over, as if he'd been talking to the unconscious man in the bed beside him. He stood up slowly, and with eyes bruised from lack of sleep, studied Cam. "So, you decided to put in an appearance. Strike up the band."
"I got here as soon as I could."
He didn't want to admit it, didn't want to believe it. The man, the old, terrifyingly frail man, lying in the narrow bed, was his father. Ray Quinn was huge, strong, invincible. But the man with his father's face was shrunken, pale, and still as death.
"Dad."
He moved to the side of the bed, leaned down close.
"It's Cam. I'm here."
He waited, somehow sure it would take only that for his father's eyes to open, to wink slightly. But there was no movement, no sound except the monotonous beep of the machines.
"I want to talk to his doctor."
"Garcia." Ethan scrubbed his hands over his face, back into his sun-bleached hair. "The brain cutter mom used to call magic hands. The nurse would page him." Cam straightened, and for the first time he noticed a boy curled asleep in a chair in the corner.
"Who's the kid?"
"The latest of Ray Quinn's lost boys." Ethan managed a small smile. Normally it would have softened his serious face, warmed the patient blue eyes. "He told you about him, Seth. Dad told him. Dad took him on about 3 months ago." He started to say more, but caught Phillip's warning look and shrugged. "We'll get into that later." Phillip stood at the front of the bed, rocking back and forth on his heels.
"So, how was Monte Carlo?"
At Cam's blank stare, he shrugged his shoulder. It was a gesture all three of them used in lieu of words.
"The nurse said that we should talk to him, to each other, that maybe he can. They don't know for sure."
"It was fine." Cam sat and mirrored Ethan by reaching for Ray's hand through the bed guard. Because the hand was limp and lifeless, he held it gently and willed it to squeeze his own.
"I won a bundle in the casinos and had a very odd French model in my suite when your fax came through."
He shifted, spoke directly to Ray.
"You should have seen her. She was incredible. Legs up to her ears. Gorgeous man-made breasts."
"Did she have a face?" Ethan asked dryly.
"Well, that went just fine with the body. I tell you, she was killer. And when I said I had to leave, she got just a little bitchy."
He tapped his face where the scratches scored his cheek.
"I had to toss her out of the room into the hall before she tore me to ribbons. But I did remember to toss her dress out after."
"She was naked?" Philip wanted to know.
"How's the day?"
Philip grinned, then had his first laugh in nearly 20 hours.
"God leave it to you."
He laid his hand over Ray's foot, needing the connection. "He'll love that story." In the corner, Seth pretended to be asleep. He heard Cam come in. He knew who he was. Ray had talked about Cameron a lot. He had two thick scrapbooks filled to bustings with clippings and articles and photos of his races and exploits. He didn't look so tough and important now, Seth decided. The guy looked sick and pale and hollow-eyed. He made up his own mind about what he thought of Cameron Quinn. He liked Ethan well enough, but the man worked your butt raw if you went out oystering or clamming with him. He didn't preach all the time, and he never once delivered a blow or a backhand, even when Seth had made mistakes. And he fit Seth's 10-year-old view of a sailor pretty well. Rugged, tan, thick curly hair, streaks of blonde in the brown, hard muscles, salty talk. Yeah, Seth liked him well enough. He didn't mind Philip. He was usually all pressed and polished. Seth figured the guy must have 6 million ties. Though he couldn't imagine why a man would want even one, but Philip had some sort of fancy job in a fancy office in Baltimore. Advertising. Coming up with slick ideas to sell things to people who probably didn't need them anyway. Seth figured it was a pretty cool way to run a con. Now Cam, he was the one who went for the flash, who lived on the edge and took the risks. No, he didn't look so tough. He didn't look like such a badass. Then Cam turned his head and his eyes locked onto Seth, held there, unblinking and direct until Seth felt his stomach quiver. To escape, he simply closed his eyes, imagining himself back at the house by the water, throwing sticks for the clumsy puppy Ray called foolish. Knowing the boy was awake and aware of his gaze, Cam continued to study him. Good-looking kid, he decided, with a mop of shady hair and a body that was just starting to go gangly. If he grew into his feet, he'd be a tall one before he was finished sprouting. He had a kiss-my-ass chin. Kim observed in a sulky mouth. In the presence of sleep, he managed to look harmless as a puppy and just about as cute. But the eyes, Kim had recognized the edge in them, that animal wariness. He'd seen it often enough in the mirror. He hadn't been able to make out the color, but they'd be dark, blue, or brown, he imagined. Shouldn't we bark the kid somewhere else?
Ethan glanced over. He's fine here. Nobody'd leave him with anyhow. On his own, he'd just look for trouble.
Kim shrugged, looked away, and forgot him. I want to talk to Garza. They've got to have test results or something. He drives like a pro, so if he had a heart attack or stroke...
His voice trailed off. It was simply too much to contemplate.
We need to know. Staying around here isn't helping.
You need to do something, Ethan said, his soft voice, a sign of suppressed temper. You go ahead and do it. Being here counts. He stared at his brother across Ray's unconscious form. It's always what counted.
Some of us didn't want a dreadful oyster to spend our lives checking crab pots. Camp shopping. They gave us a life and expected us to do what we wanted with it.
So he did what he wanted.
We all did, Philip put in. If something was wrong with Dad the last few months, Ethan, you should have told us.
How the hell was I supposed to know? But he had known something. Just hadn't been able to put his finger on it, and it had let it slide. That ate at him now as he sat listening to the machines that kept his father breathing.
Because you were there,
Cam told him. Yeah, I was there, and you weren't. Not for years.
And if I stayed on St. Chris, he wouldn't have run into a damn telephone pole. Christ,
Cam dragged his hands through his
hair. That makes sense.
If you'd been around, if either of you had, he wouldn't have tried to do so much on his own. Every time I turned around, he was up on a damn ladder, pushing a wheelbarrow, or painting his boat. And he's still teaching 3 days a week at the college, tutoring, grading papers. He's almost 70, for Christ's sake.
He's only 67.
Philip felt a hard, ice-edged chill claw through him.
And he's always been healthy as a team of horses.
Not lately, he hasn't. He's been losing weight and looking tired and worn out. You salt for yourself.
All right.
Philip scrubbed his hands over his face. Well, the scrap of days grows on him.
So maybe he should have been slowing down a little. Taking on the kid was probably too much, but there wasn't any talking about it.
Always squabbling.
The voice, weak and slurred, caused all three men to jolt to attention.
Dad, Ethan leaned forward first, his heart fluttering in his chest. I'll get the doctor. No, stay. Ray mumbled before Philip could rush out of the room. It was a hideous effort.
This coming back, even for a moment, and Ray understood, though, he could feel the pressure of his hands on his hands. He heard the sounds of his son's voices and the fear and anger in them. He was tired. Oh, God, so tired. And he wanted Stella, but before he left, he had one last duty.
Hair. The lid seemed to weigh several pounds apiece, but he forced his eyes to open. Struggled focus. His sons, he thought. Three wonderful gifts of fate. He'd done his best by them, tried to show them how to become men. Now he needed them for one more. Needed them to stay a unit without him and tend to the boy. The boy. Even the words had weight and made him wince to push them from his lips. The boy's mine. Yours now. Keep the boy. Whatever happens, you see to him. Cam, you'll understand him best. The big hand, once so strong and vital, tried desperately to squeeze. Your word on it.
We'll take care of him.
At that moment, Cam would have promised to drag down the moon and stars.
We'll take care of him until you're on your feet again.
Ethan, Ray sucked in another breath, wheezed through the respirator. I'll need your patience, your heart, your fine waterman, because don't worry about that. We'll look after him. Philip, right here. He moved closer. Ben and Lou, we're all right here. Such good brains. You'll figure out how to make it all work. Don't let the boy go. Your brothers, remember.